Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm very happy to be here today. I have the best memories of the London conference 3 years ago. I hope and wish that this Athens conference will be likewise inspiring and interesting. And I want to thank the Levantine Heritage Foundation, its trustees and the chairman and the organizing committee for their effort and commitment to this cause. The title of my presentation today is Merchant Office Holders in the Long 18th Century Levantine Trade, Non-Business Profit-Seeking Mechanisms, Power Politics and Levantine Identity. Since the 16th century, the system adopted by European countries to organize and finance their diplomatic missions, the kind of institution, public or private, that was entrusted to carry through this task, and the procedures by which consular officials were elected, differed considerably from one country to the other. Despite their differences, these systems had also many similarities. All European consuls were assigned a twofold task. They were at the same time vehicles of national sovereignty, conveying to the Ottoman authorities the policies of their respective governments, and they were delegated to supervise and protect their fellow citizens. They also collected taxes and duties imposed upon trade and navigation. All European countries appointed high-profile citizens or wealthy members of the upper middle class as consuls. Some amongst them were distinguished Levant merchants. Despite the restricted validity and their constant modifications, the capitulation agreements signed between the major European nations and the Porte since the 16th century bestowed to the consuls and the merchant communities a legal basis upon which they could rely when negotiating their status, privileges and duties with the Ottoman officials. They also outlined the European consuls' jurisdiction and responsibilities and described procedures and customs which involved them and related with the life and the activity of the European subjects. The intensification of trade transactions between Europe and the Ottoman Empire from the 18th century and the arrival of a large number of merchants and factors in the Levant had a twofold effect upon the systems of consular representation of various European countries. First, it changed the equilibrium between political and commercial priorities carried through by consuls, who were from now on all the more implicated in the promotion of their country's maritime and commercial interests. French, English and Dutch consular correspondents of the period reveal the bulk and complexity of cases concerning trade transactions handled by diplomatic officials. Also, from this period, the European merchants operating in the Levant intervened decisively in trade politics and diplomacy, either by imposing their stance and priorities to their country's administration, as the Marseille and Amsterdam merchant elite did, or by claiming and occupying positions of consuls, vice-consuls, chancellors and treasurers in various trading outposts in the Ottoman Empire. Many recent studies comparing European consular systems in the Ottoman Empire have emphasized lately these developments and sustained that consular representation from the 18th century in particular should not be considered merely as a byproduct of European state policy and an instrument of international relations, but also as an important vehicle of group interests and individual profit strategies. This realization combines with an awareness that between the 16th and the 19th century, European consular representation systems in the Ottoman Empire developed to semi-autonomous institutions, although they remained under the control of public and private organizations in their country of origin. These semi-autonomous institutions, worked simultaneously on a plurality of levels, serving national, state, corporate, and individual interests. The image of the consul office holder dominating in the sources during this period is that of a free rider, as it has been described very appropriately, a merchant divided between his aspirations as a successful businessman and those related with his career as a public officer. Following in this analytical track, I will present briefly a number of incidents described in the correspondence of the Levant Company the chartered trading company responsible for the organization and financing of the English diplomatic representation in the Ottoman Empire since the 16th century. This incident involved officials of other European nations and are representative of similar situations concerning the French, Dutch, Austrian, and other missions during the same period. They are presented here to underscore the argument that office holding in the Levant was not a casual and coincidental situation in which merchants found themselves implicated in. On the contrary, it was the outcome of a very precise and focused process which, to be realized successfully, necessitated the use of legitimate and illegitimate means. This process entailed considerable risks, but repaid the merchants, offering them power, prestige, and material benefits. It also introduced them into a social system of power relations, affinities, and strategic alliances, in which the members of all the different European communities and their Ottoman protégé participated. From the 18th century, three very common ways to extend the benefits derived from office holding in the Levant was first, by transferring the same office from one family member to another, second, by changing offices when moving across the country, and finally, by accumulating different offices representing at the same time two or more European nations. The minutes of the English merchant assemblies in Constantinople, Smyrna, Aleppo, and Thessaloniki in the 18th century reveal the extent to which members of the same family were appointed in different consular posts in the same or different cities. I have some examples here to show you. No? I can't do it. Maybe yours can help me. The list of family names confirms the importance of family lobbying inside the Levant Company and presents those members who took over various offices. Yeah? Yes, here we have the examples of some families, merchant families, of which members were appointed office holders, were office holders in the Levant. The list of family names confirms the importance of family lobbying inside the Levant Company and presents those members who took over various offices as they moved from place to place, following their business planning and transactions. The practice of accumulating diplomatic offices representing several European countries was very common among all European merchants, particularly amongst those operating in peripheral trading centers. This trend gave a quick and effective solution to the problem of those merchants whose country was not represented officially to the border and was acknowledged by the Ottoman authorities in the capitulation agreements. Being a consul or a vice consul of two or three different countries at the same time gave a merchant further social recognition, power, security, connections, and profit. The image of the 18th century Thessaloniki's international merchant community, with English, French, Dutch, and Austrian merchants assuming different positions as consuls, vice consuls, attachés, and protégés of different European powers, is representative of many other Ottoman city ports. While public appointments were synonymous to power and security, the process through which one gained them could be long and difficult, activating bitter disputes and undercover tactics. These positions, being sought after by the members of the merchant communities, exposed sometimes their holders to unexpected risks. The fierce antagonism between contenders of the post of the English General Consul in Peloponnesus in the 17th century, described by David Goffman, was the forerunner of numerous similar incidents upsetting and dividing different European merchant communities in the 18th century. The controversy over power and authority between John Oliver, Bartholomew Edward Abbott, and George Moore, English merchants in Thessaloniki, culminating with the assassination of George Moore in 1790, reveals all the nasty aspects and obscure aspects of a conflict over supremacy and control. Bartholomew Edward Abbott, a well-known English merchant in Thessaloniki, was an extremely ambitious personality. Abbott did not hesitate to discredit his nation's consul, George Moore, accusing him publicly of fraud and plotted against him in order to get his position. Despite the support of his powerful friends in London, Abbott never fulfilled his great purpose to be nominated English consul in Thessaloniki, and he was only appointed interim consul for brief periods. The office of Vice Consul of Sweden was also passed to him by his friend and ex-consul John Oliver. Abbott's relation with George Moore's successor, Francis Charnoux, was tensed as well, and until Abbott's passing away, the powerful merchant utilized every opportunity offered to him to discredit Charnoux and put a claim on his office. Abbott's persistence cannot be interpreted only in terms of financial gains. Consuls received generally low salaries and some bonuses calculated as a percentage of the duties charged upon cargoes and vessels of their country. Although this income could be significant during periods of great traffic and could rise even more through the trade of protection patents to local and foreign merchants, one cannot imagine that revenue was the key motive putting wealthy and powerful merchants in an intense competition to gain a public office. The interior decoration of Abbott's personal office in Thessaloniki may give us an answer to this question. Behind Abbott's office desk, according to the inventory of his movable property, hung the gilded British Royal coat of arms, two wooden Swedish coats of arms, and three Swedish flags. In the reception hall close to his office, there were a number of paintings manifesting his dedication to Britain and the Ottoman Empire. A painting of Lord Admiral Nelson, another one depicting the visit of the first Ottoman ambassador to the court of King George III, and another presenting the defeat of Spain and France in Gibraltar. Beside them, hung in a gilded frame with pearls, the portrait of Madame von Koch, wife of the Consul of Austria in Thessaloniki, Count Joseph von Koch, close friend and business associate of Abbott. One can imagine that for Abbott, as for the majority of merchants operating in the Levant, social power, prestige and sociability were powerful incentives that triggered them to pursue a public career. We already know that the merchant's reputation and good name, social standing, personal wealth and connections contributed to his business success. What we learn from the following incident is that for the European merchants, prestige and social standing were important assets and distinguished them not only with reference to their position in the social hierarchy of their country of origin, but also with reference to a hierarchy of power inside Ottoman society. James Sarrell was a well-known and powerful cloth merchant from Exeter, established in Constantinople, owner of the James Sarrell & Co. In 1810, Sarrell presented to the General Consul Isaac Morier a petition denouncing the ambassador Robert Adair for infringing a hierarchy of eminence that, as he sustained, existed inside the local British mission. The whole story concerned a fur coat. During the first imperial audience granted to the British ambassador, the British merchants offered precious cloths as presents to the Ottoman officials. On the occasion, the port offered in return a number of valuable fur coats, which were distributed to the members of each foreign mission according to their rank. A fur coat was offered first to the ambassador, another one to the consul general, etc. In 1810, Sarrell protested to Morier that on the occasion of the first imperial audience of Robert Adair, this rule had not been followed, and the fur coat he was entitled to, being third in the rank, had been given by the ambassador to a British captain, a friend of his. As Sarrell maintained in his letter, a fur was not an object of, was an object of no importance to a merchant from an economic point of view, but there was, I quote, a respectability attached to it in the esteem of the world. Sarrell explained that it was a matter of principle to defend the privilege he was entitled to. If he abandoned it, then similar encroaches might follow. Being responsible for the life and career of their compatriots and protégés towards an unpredictable and most of the times unreliable Ottoman officialdom, the consul merchants were implicated in Ottoman politics and bureaucratic procedures. Having common national goals and business interests triggered antagonism among the members of the various European missions. However, it also activated solidarity when collaboration for the common good was necessary. The majority of the common actions taken by the European consuls concerned the protection of European merchants against Ottoman commercial and fiscal policies and the legitimate initiatives of Ottoman officials. Joint action to put pressure upon central and local authorities was more effective, but it also gave to all the merchants involved the opportunity to promote their personal interests directly while they expanded their network of local friends and collaborators. A common initiative amongst the many taking place during the period examined initiated during the final phase of the Napoleonic Wars, when the British consul Francis Weary received an invitation from the Russian and Austrian consuls in Smyrna to collaborate for the establishment of a common postal service. The project was expected to solve once and for all the problems caused by the slow pace of the postal service linking Smyrna to Constantinople. The British merchants in Smyrna agreed unanimously to support the Russian and Austrian initiative, as long as, I quote, the Greeks would join in. However, the project failed to realize. Obtaining first-hand reliable information was another great advantage of being a diplomatic officer in the Levant. Consuls had access to public institutions, private lobbies, and powerful individuals, providing them confidential information. This data often leaked from one merchant community to the other, and sometimes traveled abroad. Communicated to business partners and government officials. French consular reports of the period addressed to the Ministry of Foreign Affairs are full of classified information collected by an extensive network of confidants. And Thomas de Vogel, owner of the well-known Dutch commercial house De Vogel & Company of Amsterdam, sent regularly to his clients around the world information he had obtained from his friend and associate, Dutch consul in Smyrna, Van Lennep. Confidential information provided by local sources could be utilized by local consuls as a valuable means to support their arguments and demands and convince clueless public officials in London, Marseille, or Amsterdam to take their side. To support his argument that the duties charged on cargoes dispatched to Aleppo via Cyprus should be levied in Aleppo and not in Cyprus, John Barker, the British consul in Aleppo, required from his colleagues, the consuls of Austria, Holland, Sweden, and the vice consuls of Russia, Denmark, and Spain, to confirm this practice. Barker had a personal interest in this case, as he was entitled to retain a percentage of the duties he charged and collected in Aleppo as an allowance. In another case, Francis Weary collected important confidential information on Mediterranean navigation, arrivals and departures of vessels, smuggling and illegal traffic activities, piracy incidents, from an extensive network of Ottoman protégé and vice consuls serving in the Aegean Islands who were under his supervision. At a certain point during his long career, Consul Weary demanded from his superiors in London permission to join in an important British insurance company as a partner. His request was turned down immediately. It would make sense to assume that Weary was planning to channel all the confidential information he got from the Aegean Islands in his new business project. Being the consul of a major European country in the Ottoman Empire turned the merchant from an independent businessman to a public figure on a political mandate. He was therefore delegated to encounter Ottoman officials and negotiate, combining his qualities as a dealer with those of an experienced diplomat. The merchant's diplomats handled politics and international relations rather distantly, in a smooth and conciliatory manner, being educated to seek profit and choose compromise versus strife. Even so, handling politicians and powerful public servants could be stressful and even life-threatening. However, on many occasions, relations between consuls and Ottoman officials were fruitful, building up a system of mutual and lasting benefits. Hence, in 1808, during the Napoleonic Wars, Katibuklu Haji Mohammed Effendi, governor of Smyrna, addressed a letter to the Levant Company through Consul Weary, asking to be given a special British license that would allow him to safely send a cargo of Ottoman cotton wool from Smyrna to Trieste. Granting a British trading license to an enemy subject, who was also a public official, required the permission of the British government. The whole situation entailed great caution and secrecy to avoid political reactions. The license document should be handled delicately in a way, I quote, best adapted to the case. This delicate handling was eventually assigned to the consul of a third country, a well-known Dutch merchant. In September of 1808, the British license was handled secretly to Katibuklu by Jacob van Lennep, who acted as an intermediary of the British government. This successful transaction guaranteed a long-lasting relationship of trust and an exchange of favors between Katibuklu and the local British merchant community. The fact that the Dutch merchant and consul of a third country was chosen to conduct such a difficult mission on behalf of the British government, and the easiness with which the British authorities decided to satisfy the demand of an enemy subject in the middle of war, giving priority to the promotion of economic interests, shows how atypical solidarities, affinities, and connections developed inside a society geared towards profit. It also demonstrates how these solidarities were put in the service of national and corporate economic interests. Another incident referring to the British-French connection confirms the above argument. For the members of the international merchant community, war meant trouble, as it interrupted Mediterranean navigation and transactions, but it could also mean profit. This golden business rule was acknowledged by the merchants and the diplomats of all rival countries in a conflict. A letter written in 1799 by Bartolomeo Pisani, principal interpreter at the Constantinople Embassy, to the minister plenipotentiary John Smeson, Spencer Smith, reveals a number of cases of British merchants who during the Napoleonic Wars traded undercover French merchandise, protecting it from being sequestrated by the Ottoman state, then at war with France as well. The merchandise was seized by the Ottoman authorities, who suspected it was covert property of French nationals. This story's most interesting aspect is that in the correspondence exchanged on the subject, British officials did not seem to bother for the undercover partnership. Apparently, business in the middle of war took place in a distinct environment with its own rules and priorities. Inside this environment, national barriers and rivalries were transcended by individuals connected primarily through the market rules of give and take. Consuls and other diplomatic officials in the Levant, being merchants themselves or connected with other merchants and merchant families, generally felt very much at ease with these rules. Their ways contributed to the creation of a business and social environment, a kind of ad hoc society within Ottoman society, where established dichotomies, foreigners versus locals, Europeans versus other Europeans and non-Europeans, Christians versus Muslims and versus Jews, existed, but were often surpassed by the major purpose of achieving profit, benefits and protection against Ottoman authorities. Credit, partnership, marriage alliances, kin and friendship, ethnicity, religion and sociability, trust and doubt, constructed an interdependence, giving to the members of this idiosyncratic society a sense of common belonging. This sense of common belonging, combined with overlapping and sometimes opposing national, ethnic, religious, social and professional identities, was, I believe, one of the basic components of what we call Levantine identity. Thank you.